responding to my mailings, and thank you for registration. I'm happy to see people out here today, and thank you very much, everybody, for coming. So this is the agenda for today's event. I hope everybody register. We need people information so we can do similar mailings if we do an event like this in future. Now what I'll be speaking today is about the information about safe grow. What's safe grow? What are the its regulation, timeline? I'm just gonna be very brief. After me, the city gardener, Mike Wells, will be giving a very short presentation. He will be talking about managing city garden. And Jay Fullman will be talking, and he is our consultant. Beyond Pesticide had helped us a lot during the implementation of this law. They have helped us create a website. They have helped us in every process. And the main presentation of today is by Chip Osborne. Thank you very much for coming, and thank you very much for coming to Takoma Park. We are very, very thankful to you for today. And we have a lunch from 12 to 12:30. It's in a different room, so we'll show you which room that is. And then we have a break at 2 o'clock, and the question and answer session is from 3 to 4 p.m. So let me tell you, everybody out here, what's safe grow. It's a law that restricts cosmetic lawn pesticide in both private and public property throughout the city of Takoma Park, and it was passed by the council on July of 2013. So what we did is, like, the law has a list of pesticides that you cannot apply in the lawn inside Takoma Park. So this restricted pesticide were derived from three lists. I have highlighted them down there. The first one is carcinogenic, or likely to be carcinogenic, by US EPA. The next one is class 9 pesticide by Canadian Ministry of Environment. And the third one is class 1 endocrine disruptor by European Commission. So in addition to that, city also maintains a list of minimum risk pesticide. And all this information, you can find it in our Safe Grow page. It's a website, you can, and it has all this information out there. So let me move to my next slide. It's about timeline. I see a lot of commercial pesticide applicator out here today. I think the audience is mainly commercial pesticide applicator. I believe so. So, I mean, if you look at the timeline, the law went into, the law was applied in two phases. One was for commercial pesticide applicator, and one was for private property owner and tenants. For commercial pesticide applicator, the law went in effect in 2014 of March. Even though the law was passed in July of 2013, we had a huge timeline because we wanted to do a public outreach before we implement the law. So the law went into effect in March. From March to June, any violation of the law, we only issue written notice. But after July of 2014, any violation will be issued a municipal infraction. I will be talking about the penalties related to this municipal infraction in my coming up slide. So this is a timeline for commercial pesticide applicator. And for property owner and tenants, the law went into effect January of this year. So from January to till the end of June, the similar, like, there will be no penalties for violation. We will only issue written notices to them. But after that, they will be penalized similarly to a pesticide applicator. The law also allows for waiver. That means if a person have exhausted all reasonable alternative to the use of restricted pesticide, but cannot take care of the lawn, then they can submit a waiver form that I've shown on the left to the city, and we will evaluate all the information given to us, and we will see if we can provide a waiver. So it's an application that you guys have to submit, and then we will evaluate the application. The next regulation by the law is that even if you are applying any pesticide that is not in the list of restricted pesticide, even then you have to post a notice. That notice clearly said what you are applying, and it should be visible from the street, so we know like what you guys apply, and it should be left in there for 2 days after application. So yeah, you can see the notice application out there, and we have all this information in our webpage. Coming to penalties and violation. So if you are in the phase of violation period and you forgot to put a notice, then you will be subject to a Class C municipal infraction, which means a fine of $50. However, if you are in the phase of violation and if we got a complaint that they apply a restricted pesticide, then the first offense will be a Class T municipal infraction, which means a $100 fine. And a repetitive offense after that will be a $400 fine. Till date, the city has issued 8 written notices. We haven't issued any penalties, but we have issued 8 notices. So, I mean, after the initial part was about regulation. But, however, since the beginning of our law implementation, we have heavily focused on public outreach. We have created a website with the help of Beyond Pesticide, which has all the information about the law. It also has educational materials such as what to do on spring, what to do on winter, so people can follow that. We have all those information in our webpage. We have done several seminars. And this seminar is a part of it. We want people to know like what are the alternatives other than pesticides. So this seminar is a part of it, and we have created several handouts like you saw at you might have grabbed a copy. This is a copy of a handout. We have mailed them to residents. We have done targeted mailing to pesticide applicator throughout the state. And we are always in public outreach. So the other thing that we've done is like we have done several articles in newsletter informing people about our law. And another fun element that we did is like this is a window flame that we created, and a property owner can put this in their window, which says this is a pesticide-free lawn. So just a process of public outreach. And I would like to end my presentation saying that, I mean, our focus of the implementation of our law has been mainly to public outreach. We don't look for, we want to make sure people understand the law and know about the alternatives. So we will continue to do a public outreach even in coming future. So every year we'll do an event like this. So our focus will be to our public outreach. And having said that, let me go to the agenda here. So what we'll do is like throughout the presentation, we'll not take questions in between because we try to shorten the whole timeline for the presentation. So please make sure you write down your questions on a piece of paper so that you can have the questions at the end of the whole session. The question answer session will take in between 3:30 to 4, so and we'll try to answer all your questions. Now what I'm gonna do is like I'm gonna pass the presentation to Mike, our city gardener. He has been doing city garden without pesticide even before the law was implemented. So let's welcome Mike Welch, and yeah, I hope you enjoy the presentation.
Thank you all. Thank you for coming to our workshop and being in Takoma Park today. My part in Takoma Park's lawn care is mostly in our display gardens. In the fall, we mulch with lawnmowers the leaves, and we apply leaf mulch to the grass areas. We don't use pesticides or herbicides of any type out of my shop. And we introduce beneficial insects, and we encourage them through plantings. We have a diversified planting scheme in all our gardens. We have no monocultures whatsoever. We utilize plastic covering to suppress weeds and to eliminate them. We do manual removal. We use horticultural vinegar in some cases. We also use propane tanks, flame, to eliminate them in areas that are not vegetative areas. We find no significant amounts of plant loss due to these practices. We find much more damage by humans and other creatures than we do any of the plants or insects, invasive plants. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Thank you for coming out today. I'm Jay Feldman with Beyond Pesticides. A little background on Beyond Pesticides. We're a national organization. We were founded back in 1981. We're sort of a mix of folks on our board. Our board president is a pediatrician. We have a toxicologist on our board. We have an entomologist who is the IPM coordinator for the city of Boulder, Colorado. We have local activists, people, community members, parents, folks that are concerned about water, about air quality, food safety, a range, and all these folks get together and talk about, well, how can we create more sustainable systems in our communities and across the country? Takoma Park has always been on the leading edge of sustainability issues, and I think you'll see as you guys work in with different people and in different towns that this issue of sustainability comes up a lot. So our hope is that not only are we talking about what's bad, but we're talking about, what's good. And that's the beauty of this session today, that we are, forget about the enforcement and all the penalties and all the violations, we're talking about how do you create a sustainable system in your soil so that you are basically preventing pest problems. What are the tools that you have at your disposal? So we actually think of this law less in terms of what it prohibits and more in terms of what opportunities it provides for the business sector, for people managing their own lawns, what opportunity it provides to think more systems-based, to think more in terms of how do I create a living system starting with the soil and then supporting the plant, and how do you create preventive systems for specific pests that tend to be in high levels in this particular area. In that context, you should know that for the past 5 years, I've been sitting on the National Organic Standards Board, which is a federal board that implements our national organic policy, which is called the Organic Foods Production Act. And through that system, we struggle with the very questions that Takoma Park is asking. What are the appropriate systems that we can help teach people, train people, and what are the allowable materials? Because there will always be materials, and Chip will talk about that today, there will always be materials that are part of that system. But the question is, how do you create that system, and how do you utilize that system to get what we're all after, which in this case is a nice-looking lawn or landscape in our community or for our clients? So you should know, and many of you have seen, that there are what they call material review organizations that are out there implementing this federal law. One of those is called the Organic Materials Review Institute, and they actually take standards very similar to Takoma Park's, and they evaluate materials, and they then come up with a list of the allowed materials in these organic systems. So you'll see on material on bags and products that you buy, you'll see OMRI listed. Now, that's a voluntary system, so not everybody necessarily goes through the OMRI process, but partly what Chip will be talking about is how do you make those determinations and how do you integrate those products ultimately into the systems approach. Now, a lot of course, what motivates this community and motivates communities across the country is a concern about health issues. I don't know if you all came out to the hearing the other night, but, you know, you hear a lot of questions about what are the impacts on children, what are the impacts on elderly, what is the relationship between exposure and various public health diseases like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's, neurological conditions, immune suppressive diseases, and how do chemicals interact with that, whether they cause those problems or exacerbate those problems. And then once you get into the conversation, you hear a lot of controversy. Does it cause it? Does it not cause it? And, you know, you hear different interpretations of scientific studies. So for today, we're putting all that aside. We're saying we have a law. We have an incentive to look at alternative ways of delivering a product and a service to people who want a lawn. And we're saying we can do that with organic systems, as we're doing on the food production side of the equation. So we're talking basically about practices. What are the practices that have been utilized in different lawn systems? What are the efficacy of those products? How have they worked? How haven't they worked? What are we experimenting with? What is working? What isn't working? And then cost. You know, it's nice to have these conversations, but are they practical? Are they cost effective? And how do the cost issues factor in to what you charge customers, how much consumers or homeowners are going to spend on their lawns, what's Home Depot going to sell for the do-it-yourselfers, et cetera. Now, understand, Takoma Park is not unique. Although it may feel that way, it is not unique in that many provinces, as you may have heard, in Canada have adopted very similar laws to this. Home Depot is working with it. They still have product on their shelves. They're working with homeowners. And so we have, and there are communities around the country that have taken this kind of program on their public spaces. What's different in Takoma Park here is that the state of Maryland, in its wisdom, has decided to allow local jurisdictions to regulate pesticides. And in this case, the city of Takoma Park adopted a standard that exceeds, as you well know, the state standard, the state of Maryland standard. So for you, for many of you, this is an experiment because you haven't been required to think this way, perhaps. You know, the other interesting thing is you will see as Chip talks that you've already integrated a lot of the practices he's talking about. So the question is, can it become a full system and one that works in your business plan? What needs to change in a business plan? What new thinking does a homeowner need to adopt to make this work? So my hope is that, as Nima said, that this can be a training that helps elevate this discussion. We're hoping it's not a one-shot deal, as you described it, that there's ongoing discussion. I know Chip gets a lot of phone calls from folks as people ask, you know, have questions that come up and arise. We want to put you in touch with folks that can get you the answers you need as you face problems going forward. But again, let's step back from all the controversy. Try to think, well, how do I manage a lawn care system without reliance on toxic inputs? What are those systems, and what materials are available to me as I go through that process? So I'm going to turn this over to Chip, who I've been working with for many years now. But you should know that Chip comes from a horticultural background. He ran a greenhouse conventionally for many years. And then 15 or 20 years ago, he made the transition to organic practices. So he's been traveling the country talking to a lot of folks like yourselves and elected officials to talk about how to make this transition. One last thought I'd like to leave you with. This law is based on what we call a precautionary approach. It means that where there is controversy and unknowns and where we haven't figured out what the real adverse effects are, but we have question marks, we want to take a precautionary approach. We want to basically say, look, we want to be better safe than sorry. We want to utilize only materials that are essential, and we want to define those materials as least toxic. So I hope you enjoyed today's session. Save those questions for the end, but know that as we move forward, we're available to you. We'll make every resource that we have, every contact that we have in terms of professionals out there that are doing this available to you. We're just a phone call away. So we look forward to collaborating with you and moving forward. Thanks a lot. Chip, turn it over to you.
Thank you, Jay. We got a minute here. How are we going to switch over from that? We're there. Okay. All right. I've just got to. The downtime on my laptop has frozen it. So we're going to start from scratch here. So while I'm bringing this back up again, I guess it was just the fact that this was up and running and then down. So what we're going to do today is go through the science behind what is actually involved in doing an organic lawn care program or natural turf management. You know, it's really the same principles, but the protocols are very different. I never will be one that will say that managing a lawn organically is the same thing as doing a public park or a sports field, because there's something that's very different, and that's the cultural intensity. It's what we have to put into it to make that happen, to keep up with heavy use of athletic play as opposed to the more casual use of a lawn. To me, organic lawn care or natural turf management imply a proactive approach to management. It does not mean just stopping the use of certain pesticide products and think that we can just go and take those out of the equation and manage accordingly. It implies absolutely a proactive approach where we're going to put together a series of protocols that are going to take the place of those pesticides. So when that happens, pesticides come out of the equation. Something has to go back in to take their place. That's just common sense. You can't just take it away and walk away, and that will be a huge failure. What organic lawn care is not is a product for product swap. In the early years of looking at organic lawns 20 years ago, that's exactly what happened. People took a step back and said, I'm using this for my conventional fertilizer. What is my organic alternative? This is what I'm doing for an herbicide, for a weed killer. What is my organic alternative? So early on, the alternative for synthetic pre-emergent was corn gluten. Anybody ever tried corn gluten as managing? Anybody think it's wildly successful and works well? It doesn't. It's not, but that was that product for product swap. This is my insecticide. What is my organic alternative? So once we began to, you know, realize that that really wasn't the benchmark of the way things needed to happen, that really organic lawn care was something that was entirely different, that it is this truly science-based approach to management that actually, you know, makes it work and makes it successful. So pictures are worth 1,000 words. I can stand here for the next 3 or 4 hours and talk to you about the science, and we will talk about the science. But I need to show you that it can work, that there are these strategies that are going to produce the desired results. When we talk about switching out product and when we talk about no longer using those typical pesticides that we've talked about, people tend to think that there's going to be a failure. And you probably have all heard that organic is too expensive. Organic means that we cannot meet expectations, that it's going to look horrible, that it's going to be a lot of weeds. So that's kind of what information is out there that's front-loading it. Some of that is put forth by an industry that is threatened on losing some market share on product development. Other is just put out there as sort of information to cast doubt on the fact of organic, that it can actually work. So prior to getting into the science, prior to getting into telling you exactly how to do it and what it is and what it is not, I just thought I'd show you some pictures to show you that it can work. Boulder, Colorado. I started working with Boulder in 2010. Boulder, at that time, prior to that, was using herbicides, was using pesticides. They had some areas where they were doing a little bit of an attempt with organic. They had a desire to move towards a more sustainable, more natural approach and brought me in as a consultant. This is a park called Greenleaf Park. You can see here, pretty bad shape. This was under conventional management. This was a relatively new piece of property. This, at the time of this picture, was only 3 or 4 years old. It's a neighborhood park. And it was so bad, they were trying to determine what they could do, whether they were going to have to step back and blow it up and start all over again, how they were going to get this to become an acceptable neighborhood park. So as part of my overall review and looking at all the properties, I said, no, let's just keep this here. Let's just work with it. Let's do the appropriate soil test. Let's find out what's going on. And instead of reaching for product to treat symptoms, and there's a whole lot of symptoms here, let's look for the underlying problem and try to solve that problem. So in my first soil test, that's as far down as I could get that coring tool to go. So that tells me that it's extremely compacted, that there was a problem in the soil. It was wet. It was mucky. There was an odor there. So we had retained water. We had a lot of issues relating to compaction. So the weeds aren't the problem. The compaction was the problem. So number one, we had to reverse that. That's what my first core looked like. I couldn't even get to soil. That's just straight thatch. So not a lot is going on in that type of a system. On close-up, you can see turf density is minimal. Weed pressure is abundant. On close-up, there is more weed and unsatisfactory grass clumping than there is turf. Here is clover moving in and pretty much taking over portions of the system. So we began the program in April of 2011. I was there this past summer in August 2014. So just 3 years. No pesticides, an organic program, and believe me, at a basic organic program, not anything near even as sophisticated as what we're talking about today for product inputs, and that's what we turned it into by August of this year. That type of a system with very little weed pressure showing, and now has gotten to the point of being that neighborhood park that the city of Boulder is proud to have. On close up there, when I photograph, I can make a long shot look like anything I want from a distance, but when you take that camera and put it right down in the grass, that tells the story. So this involved the use of no synthetics for fertility, no synthetics for control product. It was a program that was based on addressing soil health and the health and basic needs of the turf grass. So this going from worst case scenario to best, this was a 3-year transition. And we'll talk about during the day what a transition period is. Does it always have to be 3 years? Absolutely not. Transition is something that is directly, it's a length of time that takes to go from chemical management to organic management. And that length of time is directly related to the quality of the turf system that we're dealing with, and then the degree of intensity of current and past synthetic management practices. So those are sort of the guidelines that we look at when we begin to try to determine how long is it going to take to go from point A to point B. This is worst case scenario, and it was done inside of 3 years. So that means that if we're dealing with a lawn or a public park or a sports field that is in pretty decent shape, that has acceptable turf density, that has minimal or no weed pressures, that transition doesn't have to be 3 years. That transition is going to be a period of time that is much shorter than that. So that being, that being said, sort of as the benchmark, the basis of, where we, are trying to go with this, we're going to move forward now with the idea that, yes, it can work. So then that's really what my message is here today, is to teach you some of the science. And in the amount of time that we have together today, you're not going to leave here knowing everything that there is to know, but you will get a comprehensive, broad overview on what it takes to manage this way. I call it a systems-based approach because that's exactly what it is. Jay mentioned that, mentioned a system, a biological system. So when we are talking about organic agriculture, you're talking about an agricultural system. We're talking about turf grass and ornamental beds. We're talking about that as a system. If we look at a lawn, strictly as a lawn, what we can see, that green grass that's above the soil, and if we look at it as a lawn and we just focus on that as a lawn, we're going to miss the boat because we're not looking at it as a system. We're just looking at that grass that's there for either cosmetic or functional benefit, and functional benefit meaning golf or sports or public park. So, you know, that is the concept, that when you look at that lawn, you're looking at that system. You're looking at the grass that we see. We're looking at the root system of the plant. We're looking at the soil or taking into account the soil, everything that it takes to grow that grass, as well as whatever we have to put into it, meaning product input or labor, to manage it to meet a communicated set of expectations. There is not just one organic lawn care program. The industry developed many years ago a four-step program, and that four-step program has become the poster child for grass management. Now, we all know within the professional industry, we have our own programs, and, you know, we do our own fertility and control product, but basically things are some type of a modification of that four-step program as the benchmark on how we've been taught since the late 1950s, early 1960s to grow grass. The thought is that this one organic program is a counterpoint to the one four-step program, and that's not the case. We develop multiple levels of organic programs in order to meet communicated expectations. A low level of product and labor input costs a relatively short dollars, and it's satisfactory to meet communicated lower expectations. Higher level of input, higher cost, meets higher expectations. That being said, low level of expectations is not necessarily bad. High level of expectations is not necessarily good. It is the right expectation for the site as communicated by the client or the end user, and then we develop programs accordingly. I can tell you definitively through my years of work in this subject, and I'm not just a classroom guy, I'm out in the field. Last week I was on a tractor and implementing some of these strategies in a region of the country. So I am classroom, but I am out there doing it. There's a direct correlation, direct straight line correlation between turf grass nutrition and reduction in weed pressure. So when we think about weeds, we think about reaching for an herbicide to take care of weeds. But we now know that there's a direct straight line between nutrition from the organic perspective, building that biomass and allowing us to keep certain weed pressures under control. So we're going to talk about what a turf system is. We're going to talk about the basics of soil biology, that concept that we learned at some point in high school. We were taught if you pick up a handful of soil, there are billions of organisms that nature put there for the sole purpose of growing things. Conventional turf grass management programs bypass the biological component of the soil. Rarely in a conventional program do we focus on bacteria, fungi, protozoa, and nematodes, because the products that we're using, unless we're using one of the highly reacted urea-type products that requires microbial breakdown to release it, those Uflex or those methylene ureas, those type of things that do require bacteria to mineralize it and break it down, but essentially in conventional management, we're not dealing with that. I didn't deal with that. In my 20 years of growing conventionally, not once did anybody ever teach me or talk to me about the biomass in the soil that I was growing. We were using synthetic water-soluble product to directly stimulate the plant. That's what we was taught. That was my education. We're going to talk about soil testing, why it's important, what the results are. Turf grass nutrition, cultural practices. I'll allude back and forth through here to the bigger picture of sports field management and public parks, even though I'm sure most of us in the room here are managing residential turf, but the idea that this can also be done on a larger scale. So just quickly about me, I'm a 40-year professional horticulturist. 20 years as a big-time chemical applicator, and the last 20 years practicing alternative management strategies. I've seen all the good things that pesticides can do, and I've seen some of the bad things that pesticides can do. So my experience and my work over the years has convinced me of two things. One, we probably should be reducing the amount of synthetics that we're putting out there in the environment, particularly pesticides in areas where children play and congregate. And number two, that alternative strategies work. It simply becomes a mute point. We have product in organic, and we'll touch on what that product is. If I need to intervene, there is no shortage of material in a legitimate organic program if I need to intervene during a transition period for a fungal issue or for an insect issue. I have product out there. We have product that is allowed under this statute to be able to use to intervene like that. The one product that we don't have a lot of right now that is highly effective are the herbicides, but it's the combination of this systems-based approach that breaks that dependence upon the herbicides. So 20 years, you know, each way. When I started with this pesticide, you know, my pesticide programs back in 1974, my education, university, cooperative extension, pesticides are only 25 years old. So they basically, you know, World War II. So 25, 28 years had these. So there's a huge unknown, but it was all based on risk assessment. And the idea that risk assessment said that there's a risk with all this stuff, but that, it, you know, if the benefit outweighed the risk, then it was okay to use it. Not a lot of you in the room are of the age that I am. Some of you are. But I can tell you in those early years, product came and product left the market so fast because under that guideline of risk assessment, after 10 years out there, they decided that this stuff's horrible. We got to get rid of it. Things came quickly and things left quickly. So what we talk about now is basically risk assessment is based on acute exposure. Acute exposure to laboratory animals extrapolated to the human population, 150-pound male, not infant, woman, child, toddler, a flaw. Also, risk assessment being based on acute toxicity takes not anything into account for low-dose exposures, and that's what is driving sort of the interest now to move to alternative strategies, is that it's cumulative, very low-dose exposures that are problematic over many years, particularly to young children. So that's where the interest in developing alternative strategies that work. I'm also an elected public official managing a municipal department, serving as the chair and manage municipal budgets, oversee sports field management and all public park management. So not only do I have the residential piece and the education piece and the practitioner piece, I also bring in that municipal, municipal correction. So what is a systems-based approach? It's the opposite of a product approach. So conventional management is generally product-centered. Alternative management is a systems-based approach. So now we begin to understand how this system works, and most importantly, how to make it work for us. So what does that mean? Well, back in 2002, we transitioned about 20 acres of athletic fields into organic management. The first soil test gave us information that every acre of topsoil was generating about 85 pounds of nitrogen a year. After 4 or 5 years of thoughtful organic management and the appropriate choice of natural product input, that same acreage of topsoil now was generating upwards of 150 pounds of nitrogen a year, all on natural processes. What that meant for that municipality was that was a direct straight line reduction in budget because the system was picking up more of the nutritional need and less was having to be purchased to put into that system. So what's that mean for a landscape contractor? That you will use less fertilizer 3 or 4 years from now than you do today. Does that mean that you're going to suffer economic injury? No, it means exactly the opposite. You are going to become more profitable 3 or 4 years from today. I guarantee there's not one of your clients out there that asks you how many pounds of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet a year you put down on their properties. They want it to be green, they want it to be healthy, they want it to be thick, and they want it to meet their communicated set of expectations. If you can put down X number of pounds 1,000 square feet today and put down X number of pounds minus a pound 3 or 4 years from now, you're going to bill out the same. You probably even bill more with the cost of inflation. So therefore, you have less out-of-pocket cost. you're making more money and you're delivering the same expectation to the client. So that's just the dollars and cents point of view of organic. When we are using conventional water-soluble fertilizers, what you do today, you do next year and the year after and the year after and the year after. Because those products are short-term, they get in quick, they leave quickly, and they do a certain thing every growing season. What happens with organic is that you get this cumulative positive effect that then comes back to become a beneficial aspect for you as far as less nitrogen going into the system. And down here in Maryland, that's a big thing with Chesapeake Bay and trying to reduce nutrient load in the Chesapeake. So environmentally, that's a good thing. But then just strictly from dollars and cents in the bottom line, you get better. So that municipality I was talking about was able to knock off about $6,000-$8,000 from their fertilizer budget because they simply did not have to buy as much fertilizer to meet the goals that they were after. My most important slide for the day. This is what the systems-based approach is. It is three distinct concepts that we marry together in a program that allows us to be successful in management. So that basic understanding of soil biology is certainly not going to make soil scientists of everyone in the room. We'll talk a little bit about it, what it is, and a little bit about, you know, how that works and what makes that different in a natural program. But that idea that we have billions of organisms there that are doing something, that are our partners in allowing us to become successful through two things, specifically nutritional management and disease mitigation. So there are things that are going on in this biomass that are directly related. Fungus disease in an organic lawn is rare after you get through a transition period because we have very specific organisms. Just one name, there's a fungus called trichoderma. And trichoderma is suppressive of Pythium, suppressive of some of the Rhizoctonia diseases. So as we introduce these, and it's naturally found in some soils and in some we introduce it through some of our product inputs. But as we build up this body of good guys in the soil, we are beginning to have a pressure there that can outcompete the bad guys. So a good one or two sentence definition of what this is all about is simply putting a series of preventative steps in place so that problems never get out of control. That being said, problems can arise in any horticultural situation, but with a good, firm, organic, non-chemical foundation in place, they're usually easier to deal with. The second part of this systems-based approach is the exclusive use of natural organic product input. That means the control products, if we have to, that's what your statute here in Takoma Park regulates, is what can go down as a control product. I'm going to take it one step further and say fertilizer product. I know from experience that if I continue to fertilize with synthetic water-soluble fertilizers and eliminate chemical pesticides, I'm probably going to have trouble because I'm not fully addressing that system properly. Organic fertilizers build the biomass, they build the system, they allow the system to function at its utmost level. So when we think of organic fertilizer, and I'm going to talk to you about what it is, I'll talk to you about the science and how it works, but think of it at this very basic concept. Organic fertilizer feeds the soil in turn nourishes the plant. Synthetic fertilizers, direct line, feed the plant, bypass the soil. So if we are using synthetic fertilizers and just feeding the plant, feeding the plant, feeding the plant, and not addressing the soil, we're going to have problems. Synthetic water-soluble fertility inherently can create a dependence upon pesticide control products. As a greenhouse grower for 25 years, amongst other things that I did, I can tell you for a fact that that's exactly what happens. I could take a little geranium cutting like that just about this week of the year, somewhere around the 15th or 20th of January, I would bring in a little cutting like that, and by Easter or Mother's Day, I would turn out an 8-inch specimen plant that would bring me a lot of money on the retail market. And I would force that plant. I would push with synthetic fertilizers. I was using a potting soil that had no topsoil, that had no compost. It was a peat-light mix. It was just perlite and vermiculite and sphagnum peat moss and a little bit of sand. Nothing living in that soil. And all my nutrition was controlled synthetically by me injecting it into that flower pot. So that soil did nothing more than hold that plant upright in the pot so it didn't fall over. And I controlled everything. And I could tell you by how I dialed up that synthetic injector how fast that plant was going to grow. And I manipulated all the things. And everything would grow perfectly till about March 15th. And then I had a plant that was beautiful to look at, but the tissue was soft. The tissue was lush. And now all of a sudden, insects, which are opportunistic, they looked for that soft, lush tissue. Fungal diseases, opportunistic. They came into the system. And every year between March 15th and 25th, I had to get into a program of regular fungicide and insecticide applications at 7 to 10 day intervals in order to keep that product viable to sell to bring to market in early, mid-May. Because my synthetic fertilizers were creating that type of a plant that was open to insect pressures. And that's a lot of times what happens in grass. With grass, if we're fertilizing synthetically in the springtime and we get a little bit too high with nitrogen in pounds per thousand square feet in spring and the weather turns warm, we're gonna create some really quick, soft, lush growth. If that happens, that opens up that plant for potential issues in June or July. So we understand that. So the exclusive use of natural organic product. Our fertility is now going to be from the organic perspective. We, a little bit later, we'll talk about it, but we are way beyond now just that bag of organic granular fertilizer. We now have fertilizers organically that we can deliver in a liquid, where we have been able to strip out, when we understand that nitrogen, and nitrogen is primarily what we're using to grow grass, when we understand that nitrogen is a building block of protein and amino acid, and when we have an organic fertilizer granular, then nitrogen is in the protein form. In the last 2 years, science has now been able to strip the amino acid out of the protein, give me something that is water-soluble that can be applied as a liquid application, and a handful of this powder will fertilize 1,000 square feet for under a dollar. So now I have a whole different opening of technology out there that I'm not just married to and dependent upon that bag of granular organic fertilizer. That being said, there is a place always in every annual program for organic nutrition to include granular organic fertilizer because there are certain things that that product does for us that the liquid won't do. But when I talk about the exclusive use of natural organic, that does not include biosolids, and biosolids are in a lot of organic fertilizers. So product of sewage sludge, biosolid is an inexpensive source of nitrogen, which we don't, which we do not use. And then revised cultural practices. As turf professionals, we all know the cultural practices. Things like aeration for the relief of compaction, managing thatch, seeding, overseeding, top dressing conventionally with sand, organically with a compost or a compost sand mix, good irrigation strategies, thatch management. Those are the cultural practices. In a conventional management program, historically, cultural practices have taken a back seat. We've always known about them. I knew them about them in my growing days, but they weren't important because the ability to use synthetics gives me the opportunity to override the absence of cultural practices. So we're going to talk about compaction after lunch and the problems that that takes. So if I see certain weeds in a lawn or a playing field, if I see a broadleaf plantain or a pineapple weed or a knotweed, some of those types of weeds, those weeds aren't the problem in the lawn. They are a symptom in the lawn. The problem is underlying compaction, because those are the indicator weeds of compaction. They thrive when grass struggles. So I can get an herbicide and I can knock out those weeds on a temporary basis. I can use a synthetic water-soluble fertilizer and for a short-term quick fix stimulate the grass, but I've just treated the symptom, and then that problem has never been addressed. So organically, we're going to address the problem. Just a little side note on the herbicides, on those control products, is that I'm sure that we all understand, but I want to reiterate the point that weed killers don't kill weeds for good. You cannot take a 2,4-D, you can't take any herbicide that's out there in the market and put it down in a one-time application and eradicate a weed from a system permanently. Think about clover, and I'm not going to stand here and brand clover as a bad guy. You know, there's different thoughts. We can interview everybody in the room, and everybody's going to come down on clover good or is clover bad. But let's just say that we're going to just say clover. And if the desire to take clover out of a system exists, then there's a bunch of product that you can do to take that clover out of that system. If you don't repeat that product on an annual basis, the clover's all going to come back again. So that 2,4-D takes it out on a temporary basis for a period of time. Hence the four-step program, pre-emergence crabgrass control. We all know what it is. We've all used it. But think about it. Pre-emergent crabgrass control is treating a symptom. Crabgrass is not the problem in that lawn. The problem is that you have a bare spot the size of a silver dollar or greater, that you have thin turf, minimal turf density, not enough grass plants growing in a square foot. Crabgrass is everywhere because the U.S. government brought crabgrass to North America in the mid-1800s because they thought it was going to be a forage crop, and they brought it in from the Orient. It is a C4 warm season grass that thrives in hot weather. So when crabgrass gets in, it's everywhere. So if you have any of those conditions, then crabgrass is going to be opportunistic and it's going to get in there. The problem is the bare spot, the thin turf, not enough grass plants. The symptom is the crabgrass. So now we're using pre-emergent crabgrass control, and what do? We put it down early spring every year. Year after year after year after year, we're treating the symptom. That's just what that industry wants you to do, because their revenue comes from you buying that bag every April to treat the symptom. They have no interest with that product of helping you solve the problem. The problem's going to get solved with aeration and grass seed. It's not going to come from a bag of control product. So remembering that herbicides are temporary in nature. That's why the four-step program, the weed and feed, you put it down every year, and that's how you keep the clover out. It is repeat applications. I've got all kinds of pictures where product goes down and the clover is gone. 12 months later, it starts to come back. 18 months later, back. And in 2 years, it's back with a vengeance. So that is the idea. That's sort of where we're coming from, is putting this series of preventative steps in place and elevating cultural practices to equal footing with product input and soil biology. So just very briefly, the history of it, our turf management has its origins in the Second World War. We're probably all aware of that. Chemical warfare developed these products as biocides that originally were designed to take care of, you know, or do some type of mitigation of the human population. And they found that these chemicals worked effectively against insect, weed, and disease. First marketed to agriculture, then marketed to the homeowner sector. Prior to the 1930s and prior to the pesticide era, the United States lost 14% of its crops to insect, weed, and disease. Now, after 70 years of chemicals out there in ag country, we're losing 17% of our crops to insect, weed, and disease, GMO, Roundup Ready corn notwithstanding. So clearly this pesticide treadmill is not taking us in a desirable direction. They 1950, 1960, the homeowner market developed. Prior to this time, clover was part of every lawn and every grass seed system, because clover, being a member of the legume family, is one of the beneficial families in nature that has the ability to take atmospheric nitrogen and put it down in the soil where a plant can use it. So being a legume, what happens is microscopic openings on the underside of the clover leaf that open and close at dawn and dusk, the time of the day when the air is the calmest. And nitrogen N2 gas is 77% of the air that we breathe. Nitrogen gas goes right inside the clover plant. The technical term is called fixing it. It fixes it, it then translocates it. The root system is a two-way deal, grass and clover, same thing. Exudates gets pushed back down. Water and nutrients come up. In this case, the exudate is nitrogen. That nitrogen goes down. There's little nodules on the clover, and there are nitrifying bacteria present in the soil. And through the process of mineralization, these bacteria grab that nitrogen and they convert it off to ammonium, and then the ammonium is then further converted to nitrate by the nitrifiers, and now we have nitrogen that was up here is now down here in a plant available form. So in the old days, that's what lawns were. Grass clippings were always recycled. It is the landscape industry that developed the concept of bagging and removing grass clippings from lawns. Every university, every cooperative extension, every turf grass school in the country, from University of Maryland to Rutgers, Cornell, Iowa State, on and on and on, all recommends recycling grass clippings, because putting grass clippings back will give you a pound of nitrogen a year and contribute to positive growth in organic matter content. So there is no one from the professional scientific community that advocates removing grass clippings. But we as an industry came up with that practice, and now the defense is the customer expects it and doesn't like the sloppy look. Well, if we are managing properly, those grass clippings are broken down within 24 hours by saprophytic decomposers and never get to be an issue. There are probably 4 or 5, maybe 6 cutting weeks of the year at certain times in the spring in this region of the country where grass will grow more in a 7-day period than we would like to see. And in those times, then bagging and removing might be an option for cleanliness. But basically through the other year, for the summer and fall, there is not an issue there, and people would be hard-pressed to find one. So we had clover, we recycled grass clippings. There was no such thing as lawn fertilizer back in those days. Nobody bought bags of lawn fertilizer in the 1930s. So we were self-fertilizing this system. An industry came in and they developed product, and they very quickly convinced us that that clover was a weed, and they began to create a new paradigm on how we should look at our lawns. Understanding that every blade of grass that is grown in North America for lawn or playing field or golf or public park is non-native to this continent. The cool season grasses came from Western Europe and the British Isles. The warm season grasses came from Asia and the Orient. And in their natural environments, they were never grown as monocultures. They were grown as diverse horticultural systems. We brought them over here, so now we're growing non-native grasses, and that's fine. They've adapted to this continent. But the industry then came in the early 1950s and 60s and convinced us that we needed to create a monoculture, that grass was only appropriate if it was just grass and nothing else. So they developed the chemicals to create that monoculture. So now that clover was branded as a weed, and they had a product to take care of that weed for us, they just so happened to have a product over here to give you all the nitrogen you just lost when you killed that weed. So there is a connection between controlling and fertilizing synthetically. So that's how the industry developed and was born. Conventional management involves synthetic fertilizers, chemical pesticides. It is looked at as a quick fix approach. It is a product-based approach that treats symptoms. Applications by the calendar date, multiple applications. Now we're not just sometimes doing one pre-emergence, we're doing two. We do treatments of post-emergence ongoing through the year. And generally low mowing height, the idea that we are trying to mimic that golf course fairway on residential properties. Mowing height should be governed by the genetics of the grasses. Down here you're in the transition zone, so you're growing some warm, some cool season grasses. And there are different mowing heights for Bermuda and for tall fescue. But we understand that, and we let the genetics of the grass dictate how it should be mown. For fescue grasses, every single turf school in the country will tell you the ideal stress-free height for mowing fescue is 3 inches. So, we're somewhere above that, somewhere below that, depending upon how we decide that we want to look at that system. So we end up having that. So we're trying, in a lot of cases, this really close cropped, especially with the cool season, is trying to mimic the golf course. There's actually there's sort of like a standing joke in the industry that the real explosion of residential landscape management and aggressive management of residential landscapes can be tracked to a Sunday afternoon in April of 1967. And that's when the Masters golf tournament was shown on color TV for the first time. And there's a group of men that were sitting there watching that that said, that's what my lawn's going to look like. You have to understand, though, that at Augusta National in Georgia, nobody plays golf on that. No human being steps on that except maintenance people. You're allowed to play there for about 3 or 4 months a year. Other than that, from September all the way through April, they are just working on that so that it shows from Thursday to a Sunday on television perfectly. I was in Georgia for an organic land care symposium, and one of the colleagues on the panel was a research scientist from the University of Georgia. And Augusta National was just so concerned because they needed red azaleas to bloom as backdrops for the 18th green to wrap up that weekend of television. And the weather was such that they couldn't always guarantee it. They went to the University of Georgia and said, breed me a red azalea that's guaranteed to be in color the first week of April, year in and year out. They did it. It's called Augusta. It was bred specifically for that piece of property. So that's kind of an unnatural environment that nobody plays on it, nobody walks on it, nobody does anything it, but it ends to be that benchmark, that standard that we're all held to. Natural management is natural organic product. Soil testing is the basis for our inputs. As a turf professional, when I get involved in consulting projects, large or small, I don't have any business telling somebody to go out and buy product XYZ until I have a piece of paper in my hand that tells me whether I really need it or not. Most conventional programs are put down based on nitrogen. So we have X amount of nitrogen going down in a year. Rarely is there a soil test. I work with both organic landscapers and conventional landscape contractors that simply see organic as a market opportunity. Take all this discussion of whether we're regulated to do organic or not regulated to do organic. There's a market opportunity. There's money to be made. I had an email last Friday from a landscape contractor saying, I'm a conventional company in New Hampshire, and I have a successful landscape business. But I know that there's a segment of the population out there that wants organic, and I don't know how to do it. And I sense there's a market opportunity there. Can you consult with me and teach me how to do it so I can capture the revenue from that market? That's really what it boils down to, is that we're looking at that as because we do have these viable strategies that work. But soil testing is the basis on every big project that I have. I've always got the soil test up front to show me, to guide me, because I may know that nitrogen is what grass needs in the largest amount, potassium second, and phosphorus a very distant third, and in Maryland here you have a zero phosphorus law unless you have a soil test in hand that indicates deficiency. But when we're in a conventional program, and if we're just putting down nitrogen and you've got some of the conventional fertilizers that might be no phosphorus is 30.03, and we know that good, healthy soil and fertility input, potassium should be between 50% and 75% of nitrogen as an applied material. But yet we're putting down something that has 3%, and it should be between 15% and 20%. Potassium is directly related to the stress resistance in the grass. How does it stand up to adverse conditions? How does it stand up to pest pressures? It thickens the tissue, thickens cell walls, strengthens the root system. So if we're not addressing that, if we have a system that's deficient in potassium and we don't know it, and we just continually put down nitrogen without addressing that existing deficiency, you're not going to get the lawn that you really are after. We're looking and choosing materials for their sustained benefit. We're looking to solve problems. You know, my weed killer for crabgrass in the first year is simply grass seed. And I'll show you a case study where we took a turf system that was 70% crabgrass. And I can't do it. I'll never make the claim. I can do it in 2 weeks like I could if I had the pre-emergent. But in 14 months, I took that system from 70% crabgrass to 2%. And that 2% was hand-picked out of there in about 10 minutes. So we end up knowing that we can do that. Now, the key is working with landscape companies and communicating that to the end user, to the client, that no longer, you know, are we talking in the language of quick, fixed, instant gratification, but there is this transition period here that goes. And we have, you know, we do have some strategies that we go through with transition. So we're looking to build and create and establish the healthy soils. So a little bit about the soil. Nature has put a lot in place there, a lot that we need to grow grass or grow any plant material. Our job is to optimize the system, create the ideal environment, and stop practices that compromise the system. We've got lots of organisms there that are competing for a chance to survive and reproduce. This picture actually shows a fungal organism that is snaring or entrapping a nematode. It's in the process of killing that nematode, and that nematode is going to end up is plant available nitrogen for the grass. So this is sort of what happens. We also have another relationship that happens between protozoans and bacteria, where one organism consumes another. I'll elaborate on that in a little bit. Microorganisms in the soil, just shows you what they are down in the bottom, right, mycorrhizae. Some of you may be familiar with mycorrhizae. Most fungal organisms in the soil are entirely beneficial. If we are using a turf fungicide, we're killing them all. So fungicides are selective, meaning they don't hurt a weed and they don't take anything to do with an insect. But when it comes to fungal organisms, they are non-selective. They take out the good and they take out the bad. Between those saprophytic fungi, which are the decomposers that I mentioned break down that blade of grass and decompose it, mycorrhizae are the others. And between the saprophytes and the mycorrhizae, they make up the biggest portion of that beneficial life, trichoderma that suppresses the disease. Those are all the good guys. When we reach for a fungicide, they're all gone. We take them right out. Those mycorrhizae colonize the root system of the grass plant in a forest. No one fertilizes a forest, but it's generally speaking exhibits good nutritional health. So you have a tree. The tree grows. The tree leafs out. At the end of the season, the leaves drop. They decompose. Through the process of decomposition, nutrients are made available to the tree. Mycorrhizal fungi colonize the roots of that tree. They reach out many, many feet beyond the root into the soil system, and they pull moisture and pull those nutrients right back into the tree, and that's the natural process of fertility. Successional turf grasses, which meaning the fescues and the Bermudas, do not necessarily have high percentages of mycorrhizal colonization. So we inoculate. I can get a bag of powder that weighs 1 pound that will treat 20 acres, and it will introduce trichoderma fungi and mycorrhizal fungi to that 20 acres. And I can get for really short money. So it is an inoculum that we do. So right up front in the transition period, we would inoculate with these because, again, a resource that we're going to put in there. This is the kind of numbers of organisms that we're talking about in soil. So you can see there's a lot happening down there. Probably the most dramatic and trying to make the visual is that you can get up to 9 feet of fungal hyphae, and that is the reproductive strand of a fungus, wrapped around in 1 teaspoon of soil. So up to 9 feet of filamentose, like filament-type material, all woven around in that thing. So that's that biological life. So what happens, you know, when I do my more in-depth trainings of, I do 2 and 3 day programs, and we'll spend an hour or two just talking about nutritional delivery and the biomass and what's going on there. But in a nutshell, I have bacterial organisms. So I got the bacteria up there. They are single cell microscopic, low level predators. So they're the lowest level down there. Then moving up, up the scale, we have fungi, protozoa, and nematodes. So protozoans feed on bacteria. So if I have a single cell bacteria here and it's made up of units of carbon and nitrogen, everything in nature, including us, is made up of carbon and nitrogen. This bacteria is made up of carbon and nitrogen. We have a higher level predator that's made up of carbon and nitrogen. It consumes that bacteria. It has now taken that carbon and nitrogen on. It does not need it for its own survival, and it sloughs it off. Carbon stays right in the soil as an energy resource for other organisms, and the nitrogen is in the ammonium plant available form and goes directly into the root of the grass plant. So that's how nutrition works biologically. If we use an organic granular fertilizer and we put it in our spreader and we put it down, those bacterial organisms, through the process of mineralization, break that fertilizer down. They actually take it into their bodies and convert it. And I'll talk a little bit more about that in a few minutes. But when that fertilizer has been broken down and it's in the bacterial biomass, the protozoa is the organism that releases it into the grass plant. So that's how naturally things function. That's the concept of using fertility materials to feed the soil, knowing that the soil is then going to make the delivery to the grass plant. Years of a chemical program will compromise biological activity. It's mostly insecticides and fungicides that really hurt the biomass, or herbicides, which can be strongly linked to human health and environmental issues, interestingly enough, are not particularly harsh on the biomass because they are materials that are auxins and other types of materials, and the way they work is by interfering with the growth ability of the weed. So they're not really like an insecticide killing an insect. An herbicide is somehow interfering with the growth, and they can make the weed slow down and make it grow too fast. It can make the cells explode. It can do a whole bunch of different things. There's herbicides out there that rob the weed of the ability to have chlorophyll and photosynthesize for carbohydrate production. So that's what that is. And so not really harsh on the biomass, but insecticides and fungicides are the bigger concern for the biomass mitigation. Years of chemicals can result in compacted soils. We find this all the time because as we use more and more synthetic fertilizers are salt-based materials. So if we have a 50-pound bag of a synthetic water-soluble fertilizer, a urea or an ammonium or a nitrate-based fertilizer, so if you have one of those 50-pound bags of synthetic, and if it's a 20-0-10 turf formulation, we understand the mathematics that if it's a 20% formulation, there's 20 pounds of nitrogen in 100 pounds of fertilizer. There is 10 pounds of nitrogen in that 50-pound bag. So a 20-0-10 has 10 pounds of nitrogen and 5 pounds of potash. That's 15 pounds of fertility material there. The nitrogen and the potash are mineral salts. The other 35 pounds to fill out that bag is also just salt. It is a combination of other mineral salts. So a 50-pound bag of a synthetic water-soluble fertilizer in one way or another is 50 pounds of mineral salt. Mineral salt is harsh on the biomass. So synthetic fertilizers are as harsh or harsher on the biomass. Now, if we're doing it once or twice a year, probably not a big deal. But if we're doing that high-end expectation, and high-end expectation with that type of fertilizer is generally delivering 4 or 5 one-pound applications per 1,000 square feet a year, so 4 or 5 pounds of nitrogen per 1,000 square feet a year to get that high level, once you start putting 5 pounds per 1,000 of that type of nitrogen in there, a lot of salt is going in the course of a growing season, so between a spring and a fall. So that's the kind of an impact. And in some cases, it's cumulative. So, you know, we understand that. So our job in transition is to be able to begin to rebuild the soil. Conventional view of soil. These next two slides aren't mine. They were given to me by Penn State. Penn State has been a leader in looking at healthy soils. They coined the term soil health, soil quality, prior to Penn State making that determination back in 2004, 2005, that was a fictitious term. That was not used. But Penn State, started with agriculture, and then it's moved off into land management, saying that conventionally we always looked at these three distinct areas of the soil. Soil structure, that's the sand, silt, and clay. What our soil texturally is made up of. So here in Maryland, you have a soil texture. I'm sure you're all aware of what your texture is and what your relative percentages regionally around the state are regarding clays and silts and sand. Sand is the largest particle. It's visible to the naked eye. Silt is the next size particle down. Sand is very gritty or granular. Silt is very flowering. If you have ever been out in the Midwest and managing turf systems in the Midwest, and you have a silty soil, you can put your hand in that silty soil, and it feels just like putting your hand in a bag of flour. It's very flowery feeling. Then the very smallest particles in the soil, the microscopic particles, are the clays. And they actually, instead of being large or small grains, are actually a microscopic sheet. So a microscopic sheet of clay has a tremendous surface area. And that surface area is where we get a lot of our cation exchange and nutrient retention in soils. We'll talk about that in a minute. So soil structure, soil texture. Soil chemistry. Soil chemistry involves the relative acidity or alkalinity of a given soil, the pH. It involves the organic matter content. It involves both macro and micronutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, calcium, magnesium, and sulfur as the six macros. And then it also does micronutrient. Cation exchange capacity, as I said, is a measure of nutrient retention in the soil. Cation exchange capacity happens in both the humus portion of organic matter as well as some of the clay. And there are negatively charged electrical sites that reside in clay and humus. Those negative charges reach out and attract and hold on to plus charge cations, things like potassium, things like calcium, magnesium, ammonium nitrogen. So that is potassium, all held on to strongly in our soil, and that is given to us as a result of this soil test. And then the biological aspect of it, where we have the biology. So conventionally, we looked at these as three unrelated areas. Penn State now has said that we should be looking at these as being totally integrated, that they have an influence on each other, that they are related. You can't just look at chemistry. You can't just look at structure. You can't just look at the biomass, but you bring it all together. One of the things that we're beginning to learn, and I can tell you that of all the mysteries of the universe out there, one of the things we still don't know everything about is the soil. We're learning daily, weekly, all these things that are going on in the soil. But one of the things we have been able to identify is that common area in the middle where everything intersects, and what can influence that is the humus portion of the soil. And I'm sure you've all heard of humus. Humus is misused sometimes in the industry because you may go to a store or a garden center and buy a bag of humus, or you may look at it, somebody may look at a pile of compost and say, that's a pile of humus. Well, a compost, a well-aged, mature compost pile is only 60% humus. 40% of that finished compost still has a biological process involving time to go through to get to the point of being humus. So the actual humic fraction in the soil is very, very small. If we say that organic matter in North America on average is 5%, humus is actually less than 1% of that 5%. So a very, very small fraction of the soil. But what we do in organic programs now is we will include humic additions to continually move and work to target that humic property of the soil, and that can be done either liquid or granular, knowing that if we improve the humus in the soil, we're going to improve the efficacy of organic matter, and then the system will improve accordingly. typical non-forest soil profile in most regions of the country. And here in Maryland, we're pretty much on average. I mean, organic matter is going to be higher or lower in different regions of the state. But 45% of our soil is mineral, sand, silt, and clay. So we understand that. 5% of the soil on average is the organic matter fraction. Smallest percentage of the soil responsible for the largest amount of benefits. So in that 5%, 95% of everything that we do to manage the growth of grass happens there. So small, but very important. The other two fractions at 25% each are air and water. So what that simply tells us is that if we pick up a handful of good, healthy soil, half of it is solid matter, between mineral and organic, half of it is simply air. The concept of pore space, P-O-R-E, pore space, that all soil particles, from the microscopic sheets of clay to the largest grains of sand, should be surrounded on all sides by air, air containing oxygen, oxygen critical for sustaining the living portion of the biomass, and oxygen critical for the growth of the root system. A grass root will not grow without oxygen. So when we have a waterlogged soil or when we have a compacted soil, grass suffers and weeds proliferate. So compaction is simply the downward mechanical pressure, which can happen from excessive irrigation, it can happen from heavy rain, it can happen from mowing equipment, aeration equipment, athletic play, kids in a backyard, people making a path where there never was a path. I run into that at college campuses all the time. They put a dormitory over here and a dining commons over here, and the path is over here. And then what happens? Shortest distance from the dorm to the dining hall, and now all that grass is a bare soil, bare path. Compaction. Downward pressure. Particle now touches particle. Pore space is eliminated. Oxygen is lost, and that soil quickly goes from aerobic, meaning in the presence of oxygen, to anaerobic in the absence of oxygen. When that happens, grass struggles and declines. So we have that, all soil particles surrounded on all sides by air. So that's half solid, half airspace. The moisture point of this, or the water portion, we talk about field capacity, and that's how this textural test, we talk about compaction and good pore space, and then this pie chart, it gives us strategy on how we should irrigate. So when we talk about irrigation water, we're talking about field capacity. Field capacity is the ideal moisture that should be available to grow a grass plant. So if we have this ideal setup here where we've got half of it air pockets and half of it solid matter, and we have a heavy rain event or we turn on an irrigation system, all those pore spaces fill up with water. Then through some period of time, based on soil compaction or underlying drainage issues or natural percolation, that freestanding water drains away. The moisture that is left in that root zone is now called field capacity, and that is the proper balance between air and moisture. So if we irrigate regularly above field capacity, we're going to get problems with root decline or fungal disease. If we don't irrigate up to field capacity, then in a drought situation, we may get turf grass decline from lack of moisture. So we end up managing it, you know, in that type of a term. So always trying to keep the right balance between air and moisture. Benefits of organic matter. So that small fraction, soil structure, water holding capacity. So if we have a good organic matter fraction, we will get a good soil structure. And soil structure aggregation is what it looks like, what it feels like when you pick it up. Think of that fraction of organic matter, that 5%, as the home for the microbial community. So those microbes that we talked about, they're not supported by the clay, they're not supported by the silt or the sand. They are supported and they live in that 5% organic matter. So the organic matter fraction becomes the home for the microbial community. Now we know that in an acre of topsoil, we have a lot of mineral nutrient. Most soils in the United States, and soils all vary regionally. One of the hardest, you know, parts of my job is that I may be, you know, managing here in Maryland or in New England or New York or Colorado or Illinois. Soils are different all over the country. And different things are going on, and we always need to be aware of what is going on with every individual soil. You work with the soil. You don't try to substantially change soils. You work with them as best you can within every region. More or less around the country, there is a large amount of available nutrient, unavailable nutrient in the soil. So there's a lot of, generally speaking, there's sufficient phosphorus, sufficient potassium, sufficient calcium and magnesium, but it is in the insoluble mineral form. It's in a form that the plant cannot use, an insoluble mineral. So plants can only make use of those nutrients from the soil when they become solubilized. They have to become solubilized and in soil solution, and then the plant can take them up. So with our conventional fertilizers, when we put nutrients down, they are already solubilized. So if we are putting down phosphorus through a conventional fertilizer, we're using it in a superphosphate form or a treble superphosphate. What that means is that is a natural soft rock or black rock phosphorus that is insoluble, that exists in the soil, but in a laboratory it's reacted with hydrochloric or sulfuric acid to make it soluble. So when you put down superphosphate from a fertilizer, it has become solubilized and then the plant can use it right away. In a natural system, we're not doing that. We're not reacting phosphorus. If we're amending, we're putting it in its mineral form, unavailable. So with this biomass that we talked about, one organism consuming another, this predatory relationship, as much as nitrogen and carbon are byproducts of that, so aren't organic acids. So when one organism consumes another, a byproduct is the release of an organic acid. That organic acid in the soil reacts with that phosphorus or the potassium or the calcium or the magnesium, much the same way the hydrochloric acid reacted with it in the laboratory, and it chelates it or solubilizes it. So now this big vault of mineral nutrients that is in that soil through an organic program is becoming available to us, because a healthy biomass is secreting sufficient amounts of organic acid to continually solubilize this stuff and allow it to be used without us having to go out and purchase it from a bag. So in a turf grass program that is mandated by law, and it's not just here in Maryland, it's happening all over the country. Pretty soon all 50 states will have zero phosphorus laws. If we can't use phosphorus by fertilizer, and soil test shows there's enough of it there, this is the science. This is the methodology that's going to take all that stuff that's there and put it in the form that the grass plant can use. I've just developed a turf program this past fall where starter fertilizer for putting down Kentucky bluegrass sod, and if any of you, I know you don't do too much Kentucky bluegrass, but I know at the soccerplex and things, they do have bluegrass fields. We all know that Kentucky bluegrass, of the cool season grasses, highest fertilizer, highest cultural intensity, highest water. So starter fertilizers for Kentucky bluegrass contain lots of nitrogen and lots of phosphorus, and then you repeat it, you know, typically up north a 19-19-19 synthetic is what they would use, you know, for that. I just did a turf grass installation with Kentucky bluegrass. Starter fertilizer was a 6-0-6 organic at a half a pound of nitrogen, 1,000 square feet. But the biomass released it and through my natural inputs. And in the and so went from September through the end of the season in November, introduced less than 0.9 pounds of nitrogen, zero phosphorus, but we introduced specific biological organisms, phosphorus solubilizers and others, where we got the benefit of about 1.75 pounds of nitrogen by putting down only 0.9 pounds. because the biological part of the program released everything that was in the soil for us to be able to meet that expectation of what it took to manage that Kentucky bluegrass. So that's the kind of thing that we're talking about. pH buffering ability. If we have an acidic soil, we know that once we establish this biomass, and turf grass prefers more bacteria than fungi. So if you look at a fungal to bacterial relationship for a tree, it's 20 parts fungal to one part bacterial. If you look at that same ratio for grass, it's 3/4 fungal to one bacterial. So we end up establishing the bacteria where we want it to be. Bacteria as an organism are neutral pH, 7.0. So if we get that balance correct, now we have a substantial biomass of pH-neutral material, and we can offset an acidic soil without the use of lime, simply by establishing the biomass in the right relationship. As organic matter decomposes, so in that 5% organic matter fraction, things are decomposing all the time. Microorganisms that have been deceased, root systems, blades of grass. Through the process of organic matter decomposition, soil aggregation improves, nutrients are released immediately in a plant-available form, some that can be used in the very short term, others that are building in there for the longer term, and we know that biological activity increases. If we have low organic matter soil or don't have good resources, meaning very compacted or anaerobic, microbial life simply won't survive in large amounts. Fred Magdoff, professor, University of Vermont, did a lot of the work that we have today in soil nutrition and organic matter. And he called decomposition for energy, or the residue of life, breaking that 5% organic matter fraction down into these three distinct areas, living, dead, and very dead, with the very dead being humus. Think of humus as the end product of decomposition. When anything organic, whether it's a blade of grass or a leaf or an apple that goes into a compost pile, when that goes through that decomposition process and absolutely can break down no more, it becomes humus. The living and the dead fraction can be roots and earthworms, insects, microorganisms, plant residues. So that is how that all works. We look at things in the short term. In the short term, biological activity increases. We get increases in temporary aggregation. We get improvements beginning to be seen in structure and tilt. Tilt is the term for soil health. We get an increased, immediate increase in nutrient availability. But most importantly, in the long term, we get biological diversity increasing. Total organic matter fraction, we can begin to move that 5% up. So if we're at 3% and we know that root systems of grasses grow and then they slough off at the end of a year and then they regrow, all that breaks down and decomposes and helps to build the organic matter fraction. Aggregation becomes more permanent. We get long-term and permanent improvements in health, water holding capacity, water infiltration, ability to till or aerate. Aeration is the tillage in an organic system, a turf system. And then we get improvements associated with organic matter levels, cation exchange capacity, buffering capacity, and nutrient availability. So yes, we're concerned on the short term, but we also have our eye on the longer term. Just a chart here that shows across the board everything that is happening when we make an organic matter addition. So if we recycle grass clippings, if we put leaves under a mower blade in the fall, which we should be doing in a turf system, there's all kinds of science that shows that one of the worst practices is to come through with a blower and blow all the leaves off of a lawn in the fall before you cut the grass to take them off. University research absolutely substantiates that if you do that, if you collect all the leaves throughout the fall and take them off and compost them into leaf mold, and then a year or two later return them as a top dress to the turf, or if week by week throughout the fall they go under the mower blade, you can't take leaves that are that deep and put them under a mower blade and, you know, chop them all up, you'll smother the system and you'll get into a fungal issue. But if a reasonable amount of leaves on a weekly basis are ground up, this research showed that at a 3-year period, the benefits to that soil and the turf system were identical. So grinding, mulching leaves in place as opposed to composting them and returning the compost, absolutely the same benefit to the system. As we add organic matter, biological activity increases, decomposition is undertaken, nutrients are released, humus is formed, the soil becomes to be aggregated to a better level, pore space improves, the health improves, and the end result, the grass improves. We'll talk a little bit about a compost top dress. People ask me all the time, if you had the one thing, if we were doing an organic transition system for a lawn, sports field, what's the one thing that you could do if labor resources allow and if budget allows that would make the biggest difference to go from point A to point B successfully? It would be the ability to spread 1/4 of an inch of compost over a turf system. Not something that needs to be done year in and year out, but something that we generally do during this transition period. Compost, by definition, is the product of an aerobic process whereby microbes break down and decompose various forms of organic matter. So we have feedstocks or substrates, can be leaves, it can be grass, it can be food waste, it can be, you know, animal bedding, it can be any one of a number of things. They can be random materials like you would find in a municipal situation, or a commercial composter would, if we had a food waste composter, he is taking that food waste and doing a very scientific relationship of that food waste to other carbon materials, whether it's wood chips or leaves or overs from the previous compost pile, to make up his recipe. These organisms use that substrate as a food source. They produce heat, carbon dioxide, water, humus. Humus is that end product of decomposition. Nutrients and pH are stabilized. Good compost, by definition, should be somewhere between 30 and 40% organic matter content. It should have a pH near neutral, between 6.8 and probably 7.4. It should be, you should, you know, have a compost chemistry test that shows that it is satisfactory with retained nutrients. A biological assay should be done to show that it has the appropriate microbial life in there. The compost that was sort of always desired was this really high nutrient-rich compost, which we can get with a manure or a manure-based product. Now, under sort of this new legislation and looking at nutrient, now, all of a sudden, some of the most valuable material out there is simply leaf mold. So when we look at a compost analysis, we don't think too much about the analysis, because a compost analysis can be like simply like a 1-1-1. All right, so 1-1-1 doesn't seem like a lot, because we're used to looking at bags where we have numbers at 10 or 15 or 20. So you're looking at a bag with big numbers, and now all of a sudden you have a compost of a 1-1-1. But when you understand what that 1-1-1 is, and if you spread 1/4 of an inch of compost over 1 acre, you are, you know, you're doing it roughly 20 yards to the acre to get a 1/4 inch top dress. When you put 20 yards to the acre, which translates to between 10 and 15 ton of compost, you have just introduced over 400 pounds of nitrogen and 600 pounds of phosphorus. On a 1-1-1 or a 1.5 phosphorus. So now that's a lot. That's all, because an ag recommendation for a hort, for an ag application is only 80 to 120 pounds of phosphorus. So we need to be careful. I know that in, here in Maryland, I've spoken to representatives last year of the Department of Ag, and they will be looking at the compost right now is exempted from regulation, but it is going to be looked at under a new set of eyes. So the idea that leaf, you know, just leaf and grass clippings is, even though it is a lower analysis of retained nutrients than a manure-based product, it becomes more desirable because it now falls, you know, the phosphorus can fall under trace amounts. So a leaf mold compost can be just 0.5% phosphorus, 0.5, 0.6, and then that can end up, you know, being minimal. because we know that organically we can do whatever we need to do to introduce nutrient in addition to the compost based on requirements by law. So from the compost, we're after organic matter and, most importantly, active biological life, because it's that biological life. It is the fungal life and the protozoan life in that compost that are going to trigger organic nutrition, that are going to trigger that trichoderma for that disease resistance. So in a transition project or period, it, the ability to use compost sort of jumpstarts the system. No national criteria, standards, guidelines. We need to rely on testing and our own assessment. So there should be no offensive odor. There should be no ammonia smell, no bark mulch smell, no remnants of initial feedstocks. It should look, smell, and feel like a quality soil, and it has to be mature. And maturity can only be determined by testing and established C to N ratios. We know that if we want to make good compost, we need, you know, we have a carbon, again, that coming back to that carbon to nitrogen ratio. Good compost should be 20 to 1, 30 to 1 carbon to nitrogen going into the pile, and 12 to 1 to 20 to 1 carbon to nitrogen ratio in the finished material. So if we have anything different than that, we've got a problem. So just the short message with compost is that all compost is not created equal. I could put three piles in front of you, and we'd all look at it, and it would look pretty much identical to all of us. But then if I could show you testing results, and they're going to be all over the place. So if anybody ever does purchase compost for any reason in a horticultural situation, should always ask for and request a test. Immature compost. If you use immature compost, you can shut down and destroy a turf system in as little as 72 hours. Because once organic processes begin to decompose things, nature wants to take it all the way to the end. And what happens is if you have an immature compost material and you put it down on the soil, it literally pulls nitrogen from the soil to try to finish and fuel to drive that process. When nitrogen leaves the soil, chlorophyll, the blades of grass, chlorophyll in the blades declines. Grass goes from green to yellow. Yellow grass can't properly photosynthesize to produce its own food, and then the system can shut down and die. So that ends up to be a problematic situation. So we're at about 11:57 now. When do you want to, stop now for lunch? It's either going to be probably the best right now or about 10 minutes from now. This is a perfect place to stop right here.
Yeah,
all right.